Our next speaker is Lieutenant Aliza Landis, who's the head of the new media unit in Tsahal of the IDF.
Calling us a unit is very generous. We're more like a desk. Currently, I actually have 5 soldiers and we'll be getting an additional 5, which is quite an increase from where we were about a year and a half ago when it was just me and one other soldier. Basically, I think that there are a couple of critical points here. What was mentioned earlier regarding the sort of rear view medium syndrome. I think that as much as new media has its own language and its own requirements and its own behavioral codes and norms, there is a way to sort of transform material that we put out for standard traditional media outlets and make it, translate it for the online community. And I think that oftentimes for large bureaucratic organizations and institutions that have difficulty transforming or adapting quickly to something, to a challenge like the challenge that the Web 2.0 poses, it's a good way to start of begin the path towards really getting involved in the new media world. We, at the IDF Spokespersons Unit, one of the largest challenges that I've had to face is convincing the rest of the Army why the type of teaching them about the type of material that we need to put out online and why it's important. And it's not the standard calculus that you have with, oh, it's very clear to me why I need to put somebody up on CNN. It's very clear to me why I need to give an exclusive to the Times of London. You know, France 24, of course they're important, we have to deal with them. And you say things like, well, I think we need to be tweeting out all the updates, or hey, let's put up a vlog on YouTube, and that sounds very foreign. And one of the biggest accomplishments, I would say, over the past 2 years since Operation Cast Lead has really been the sort of opening up to the idea of new media that I've seen in the Army and also elsewhere within as you know, official organizations in Israel. If we look at what the police have done in the past several months with their Facebook, it is really, really remarkable. I was actually with them yesterday, and one of the things that they said, they opened up a Facebook page, and it's only two people, they work 24 hours a day on the Facebook, manning it, answering questions, and they've actually managed to locate 11 people, 11 missing people, by putting up the information on Facebook. So the real-world consequences for new media is there's enormous potential there, and it's also something that people can understand, or you know, people who might be resistant to using new media can understand that there are real-world results that you can get from it, and that sort of creates more of willingness to listen and to adapt to the medium, even though it seems very foreign and difficult for a lot of people. In terms of the IDF, what my desk tries to do, we work differently in an emergency period and in during standard periods. In standard periods, we're basically trying to build up our network so that in emergency periods, people know that they can go to us for information and that we're reliable and as accurate as humanly possible, because obviously there are humans behind these tools and there's always a margin of error. Because I'm sort of in this middle path where on Twitter, for example, we don't really reach out to people very much and we don't always respond to questions a lot of the time because the questions are inflammatory, most likely rhetorical, and frankly obnoxious. So we would avoid those. Questions that are factual, people are actually just looking for information, we do respond to those. But that's not the way most Twitter accounts work. Most people are constantly active on them, they're responding to people, they're engaged in conversation. And because we are the official, we're the voice of the IDF on Twitter, we still have to apply the same standards for our behavior and the accuracy of our responses that we would if we were giving an interview on the radio. And that's something that people have a hard time understanding sometimes, and it's something that We're trying to find different solutions to sort of adapt more to the culture of Twitter. But in the meantime, what we're trying to do is put out as much information as possible. I like to refer to it as the democratization of information. There's a vast online conversation going on about Israel at any given time. And the important thing for me is that we have a presence in that conversation. We're not the most advanced presence. We have a long way to go, but this is a start. 2 years ago, we weren't involved in the game at all. We had no real online presence. We had a website which was not very good. It's now been upgraded and it's about to go through another upgrade, which is very important. But we weren't putting out the material that we distribute to mainstream media outlets. We weren't putting that online. Announcements weren't going out online. Photos that we were emailing journalists weren't going online. Videos that we were releasing to mainstream media outlets weren't going up online. And that cut out an enormous population that is actually very influential, which is specifically bloggers, as well as just the average user, because let's be honest, with everyone having an average of over 100 friends on Facebook, anytime you post something up, you're sort of like a mini AP or a mini Reuters or a mini AFP, whatever. You're a mini news agency in and of yourself because you're distributing information to your friends, and actually that information has more weight because it's coming at the suggestion of a friend. In any event, we now put up all of this information that used to be the sole purview of the mainstream media, we put it up online. That doesn't mean that we're giving exclusives to every blogger who comes along, but it means that now they have access to use this sort of information in whatever way they see fit. People can use our pictures on Flickr however they want. Obviously, I would prefer if they weren't photoshopping the photos to make it look like they were war criminals and then posting it up on their blog, but that's part of the price that you end up paying for making material available. And I think that making information and material available is paramount and more important, and in the long run will even itself out in terms of the risks that you run. Anyway, so questions, answers later.
Thank you very much.